sur cette nièce. OK, so maybe it's time to start now. So I'm glad to introduce Sylvain Gandon from Montpellier in France. He will talk today about the speed of pathogen adaptation to vaccination. So please.
Thank you. Thank you, Pierre, for this invitation to talk. So I'm going to talk about some of the work we've been doing on the modeling of the evolution of pathogen adaptation. So in particular, in the current context, I think this kind of formalism may help to clarify some of the concepts that have been discussed by different people. And so that there's been quite some controversy at the beginning of this pandemic. And I'm just going to recall this this paper, which was published February 2 years ago, really at the beginning, where some experts, in particular Edward Holmes, who is really an expert in emerging disease, were claiming that it was very unlikely that an emerging virus would adapt to the human host during the outbreak. And now we know that the COVID and the SARS-CoV-2 had the ability to adapt indeed, because there's all these variants that emerged towards the end of 2020. So first there was this alpha variant that was detected in UK, and then also the delta variant that first emerged in India and that now is spreading globally in all the countries. And so that was really a surprise for most experts, because usually there is this common view that evolution is much faster than epidemiological dynamics. And what we saw with SARS-CoV-2 is that selection and the arrival of those variants can be actually be very, very fast. And indeed, it can be so fast that it can really challenge all the control efforts that are being carried out to control the dynamic. So it's very important to take into account evolution to manage the current pandemic. So all those variants that I'm plotting on those graphs are actually arise before the start of vaccination. So vaccination started in 2021. So now the large fraction of the West world is vaccinated, but there's many countries that are not vaccinated. And the fact that so many people are, some people are vaccinated is going to select possibly for new variants that may escape the effect of vaccination. So that's concerning. And one question that comes to mind is, can we try to understand this process of adaptation to vaccination? So it's I'm not going to answer this question. I'm just trying to provide some framework to try to think about the process and maybe to help them think more clearly about the process and maybe help give some advice about how to manage the disease during the vaccination campaign. So how to conceptualize the effect of vaccination. So typically, so I'm going to use those graphs where I'm plotting here the density of the infection, so the number of cases, the incidence, and we start vaccinating. So this is time. And what we hope is that after the start of vaccination, if we have very good vaccines, the density or the prevalence of disease will drop. Eventually, it will reach a zone where it will be subject to demographic stochasticity, which may eventually lead to eradication of the disease. Okay, but in the case of COVID, we probably not in these situations because there are many reservoir hosts, and we know that we cannot vaccinate everybody in the population. So it's very likely that vaccination will result in new endemic equilibrium, possibly with oscillations and new waves. So during this new equilibrium, then there might be new mutations that may arise, mutations that may allow the pathogen to escape vaccination. And typically, that's the kind of things we want to understand. So one key component of this dynamics is the time of arrival of the mutant. So typically, the mutant may arise at some point in time, but if it is very rare initially, because it will just happen by mutation, it's very likely to go extinct. So it won't escape this stochastic threshold. So it will go extinct very rapidly. But many, in some situations, unfortunately, maybe the mutant will manage to invade, so to pass this stochastic threshold, and it could either go back to extinction if there was a very perturbed dynamics of the mutant. It could also coexist with the wild type, or it could go to fixation. Okay, so that's the kind of dynamics we want to understand. So from this first description, you see that one difficulty to model adaptation is to deal with the stochasticity that may happen at the very early stages of the invasion. So this is the outline of my presentation. And I'm going to just to follow the steps of pathogen adaptation. So the first step is, of course, the arisal of adaptive mutations. Are there any adaptive mutations in SARS-CoV-2? So that's sort of one question. The second is, if those mutations arise, do the mutants manage to escape early extinction, and can they invade the population? So that's another question. And in a second step, so when the mutant manage to escape the early risk of extinction, it will reach a high frequency in the population. And when it reaches a high frequency, then we can use deterministic models to understand the dynamic. And if I have time, I'm going to present some results of modeling, so deterministic models that can be used to understand the single locus evolution of the virus, and then speak a little bit about multi-locus evolution as well. So the first point, are there any adaptive mutations? Are there any mutations that may allow the virus to escape vaccination? So early on, so again, that's a paper that was published in 2020. Experts were really reassuring, because by just looking at after sequencing SARS-CoV-2, they realized that actually the diversity, so this is a measure of diversity and some protein that sticks up on the surface of the virus, was much lower than, for example, influenza viruses. So all those viruses are RNA viruses that are famous for having high mutation rate and therefore potentially high rate of adaptation. But SARS-CoV-2, fortunately, ends on the gradient where it has a very low mutation rate compared to other RNA viruses. So that was quite reassuring. Yet, as we saw, there's many variants that are spreading that have increased contagiosity on human population. So we know that adaptation is possible. And also something that we know from those immune assays, we know that some mutations, so those are a list of mutations, so the red mutations allow the virus to escape immunity carried by antibodies. So those are different classes of antibodies. And when the numbers are high, it means that the virus is not controlled by the antibody response. So there is some variation in the current population of the virus carried by these mutations that implies that maybe some virus may be able to escape the immunity that is provided by the current vaccine. But fortunately, the current vaccine are working very, very well. So there's no variant that is known right now that can escape the current vaccine. So that's why we should vaccinate. We should keep vaccinating, because it's a very efficient tool to control disease, and it saves lives. So there's no question about that right now. What I want to address is, what would happen if some mutants that would be able to escape the vaccine would arise by mutation? What would happen? Will it invade the population? So this is a work carried out with Todd Parsons, Amaury Lambert, and Troy Day. And so what we've been using is a toy model. So again, I want to be very careful here. This is a very simplistic description of the complexity of the virus life cycle. So here we just going to use the simplest SIR model to study epidemiology and evolution. So we're going to assume that there is a flux of susceptible hosts. They can arise by birth or immigration, they can die, and then they can become infected at some rate, which is the force of infection, which depends on the transmission rate and the density of infected hosts. And the subscript I here indicates that there might be different variants circulating. And so the force of infection by different variants may depend, for example, on the transmissibility of the different variants, and of course the density of the variants in the population. And when the population, the host is infected, it can recover or it can die from the infection. And vaccination may arise either at birth at some rate, or and this is more relevant for COVID right now. So there might be a rate of vaccination of adult individuals. And if you're vaccinated, you have this dotted line around you. And then you can also, the vaccination can wane. So there is a flux on both sides to figure out this dynamics. And okay, so the vaccines, as we know, can have different effects on different at different steps of the life cycle. So for example, they may have an effect on the probability to be infected or to on the other hand, it could not prevent infection, but it could decrease transmission. So to describe the diversity of effects of vaccination, we use those parameters, rho. So rho one will be the efficacy of vaccinations to cut transmission, to cut infection. And then rho two will decrease the growth rate in the parasite. Rho three will affect the transmission rate. Rho four will affect virulence. Rho five, the rate of recovery. So there are all these different effects that we can use in this model. So I'm not going to analyze fully this model here. I'm going to go straight to a simplest version. A simpler version where basically we're going to focus on the parameter rho one, so the ability to block infection of the vaccine. And we are going to consider a variant, a mutant that is has the ability to escape recognition by immunity. So it will have a higher probability to infect vaccinated hosts. Okay, so the mutant, the vaccine escape mutant, has a higher parameter E, which will allow it to infect more easily vaccinated hosts. Okay, so when we take this model, so we can use a system of ODEs to describe the deterministic dynamic of the system. So there are two equations that describe the density of uninfected hosts. So they can be naive or vaccinated. So the hat symbol refers to the state vaccinated. And then you can track the density of the wild type variant, the resident variant in the naive host or in the vaccinated host. So we are going to assume that possibly the vaccine is not perfect. So even the wild type can infect vaccinated hosts. And to study evolution, we need to incorporate the dynamic of the mutant in this system. So I'm just for clarity, I indicate it in orange. So all the equations in orange refer to the mutant variant. And as you can see there, the mutant has a different value of escape. So we are going to assume that this probability to infect vaccinated hosts is higher than this one. Okay, so this is the full system that describes epidemiology and evolution. But to really address the question of the speed of adaptation, we need some way to quantify the speed. And for that, we can focus on the change in frequency of the mutant. So the frequency is simply the ratio of the density of hosts infected by the mutant over the total density of infected hosts. And we can actually derive the change in frequency of the mutant, and it takes this form. So this term here is a measure of the genetic variance in the population, and SM is a measure of selection. So selection, if it is very high, it will speed up the rise of the escape mutant in the population. And these coefficients of selection, so it's really simply the difference between the per capita growth rate of the mutant and the wild type. And those per capita growth rate are also simply the difference between the birth and the death event. So the births are going to be all the events that will lead to a higher number of infected hosts. So it will be a function of the transmission rate, but as you can see, it will also depend on this parameter E, which is the ability to escape vaccinated hosts. Okay, so when this number is high, it allows the strain I to infect vaccinated hosts. So it increases the fitness of those lines. And this is really the sum of all the events that will cut the infection. So it can be either due to death, but also due to recovery. And just a warning here is to be very clear about what I'm using here. So the little r, the per capita growth rate, so those are instantaneous rate of growth, whereas the big R refers to the per generation. So they are tightly connected, but here you see that the big R is simply the ratio between the births and the deaths, whereas here it's the difference between the two. Okay, so these two quantities are different. This is very important to understand the virtual dynamics. So to really formalize adaptation, you need to think in terms of steps. So the first step is really the arrival of the escape mutant. So we have to first to formalize the event of apparition of the mutant. So the mutant is not going to come out of the blue, it will come from the wild type. So that's why we're going to assume that the flux of mutant will be determined by the dynamics of the wild type. So the wild type is this blue dynamic. So we see that the vaccination is going to affect the dynamic of the wild type. And as a consequence, it will also affect the rate of apparition of the mutant. Okay. And in fact, you can figure out the probability that the first escape mutant will arrive at a given point in time after vaccination. So this is what I'm representing here. So this is Tn, the time after the start of vaccination. So I'm counting time from this point, and I'm looking at what time does the mutant will arise. Okay, so in this figure, it arrives at that time. And here I'm just computing the probability of arrival at a given point in time. So this is for a case where the speed of vaccination is relatively low. Okay, so mu is the speed at which you vaccinate. So there's a few vaccinated hosts in this population. And when you increase the vaccination rollout, so when you increase from 0.1 to 0.5, what you see is that it will have a huge impact on the density of the wild type, okay? Because when you vaccinate faster, you will have a faster drop of the wild type. And as a consequence, it will delay the time at which the mutant will arise. And in fact, when you vaccinate a lot and at a high speed, you can actually delay for a very long time the arrival of the mutant. So it has a huge impact on the probability of this event to even occur. Okay, so that's the first step of adaptation, the arrival of the mutant. And then the second step is whether this mutant, if it arises at a given point in time, will invade or not. So to look at that, I'm going to take a few numerical examples. So here we're going to look at a situation where we have a wild type that cannot infect the vaccinated host. So EW is equal to zero, but it can transmit relatively well. So it has a high transmission rate. And we consider the fate of a green mutant, which completely escapes the vaccinated host, but it has somehow a lower transmission rate. So there is a cost of carrying this escape mutation, which means that before vaccination, the per generation fitness is lower for the escape mutant. But after vaccination, because it can escape free the vaccinated host, the mutant will be able to outcompete the wild type. And so this graph is simply plotting the probability of invasion of a mutant, of the green escape mutant, when it is introduced at different points in time. Okay, so this probability is simply given here by this quantity, which was derived from by Kendall, because it's a non-homogeneous birth-death process. So it's a birth-death process, so the births and the deaths are defined earlier on. But as you can see, the death is a constant rate in this model, but the births is not constant in time because the density of susceptible and vaccinated hosts will change with time. So typically, after the start of vaccination, the density of naive hosts will drop, but the density of vaccinated hosts will increase. Okay, so this birth term will vary with time as a function of the epidemiology of the system. So you can compute this quantity, and that's what I'm plotting here. So what you see is that early on, if the escape mutant arises very early on, it is very unlikely to go to escape early extinction. So the probability of invasion will be very low because there is very little vaccinated host at this point in time. And since there is a cost of this escape mutation, it has a lower per generation fitness, it's very unlikely to escape early extinction. It's only if the variant arises later on after vaccination that there is a risk of invasion. You can also compute what happens right when the mutant is introduced very late after vaccination, and it's actually interesting to see that it only depends on the per generation measures of fitness in this case. And you can also play with this model to look at what would happen if there was another escape mutant. Instead of the green, you imagine a red one. So it's also fully escaping the vaccine, but it has a much higher transmission rate, but also a much higher virulence, which means that this red variant may have a larger per capita growth rate than the mutant. Yet it has the same per generation fitness. Okay, either before or after vaccination. And what you can see, quite surprisingly, because you may think that because it has a higher fitness, it should increase, have a higher probability of invasion. In fact, it's the opposite. The red line is always below the green one, and it's simply because the red one has a much more aggressive dynamic. So it has a higher birth rate, but it also has a much higher death rate, which means that overall, the risk of extinction of those variants are much higher than the green one, which leads to a lower probability of invasion. So in this case, it's reassuring because these virulent variants are less likely to invade in this model. And then we can also look at what happens after invasion. So here, it's just this probability only computes what happens at the early stage of the invasion, so whether it will escape early extinction, but we want to know see what happens after that. In fact, with the green mutant, so in this numerical example, we see that invasion always leads to fixation, but sometimes with the red mutant, you can also have invasion and then later on extinction, and we can capture that with this model. So I don't have much time to discuss that, but qualitatively, if we go back to this figure that I showed earlier, so the fast mutant falls into this category. So sometimes it can escape early extinction, but it's very likely to go back to extinction because it has a too explosive dynamics. Whereas the green one, the slower strain, falls into this category. So when it invades, it usually leads to fixation. So can we use this model to say something useful about what would be the impact of, for example, the rate of vaccination, so the speed at which we vaccinate the population on the probability of adaptation? Because what we've seen is that when you crank up the rate of vaccination, you see that there is an impact on the mutation process. So when you increase the vaccination rollout, you delay the time of arrival of the escape mutation. But on the other hand, what you do is that you vaccinate more people. So if you have more vaccinated hosts in the population, the selection for those vaccine escapes is going to increase. That's what we see here. The green line is higher when you vaccinate faster. So what you want to do is to put all these things together. And in fact, you can do that by simply computing the probability of adaptation of the escape mutant as a function of the speed of vaccination by integrating the time at which the mutant will arise and the probability that this mutant will invade given its time of arrival. And interestingly, you get this kind of shape. So here I'm plotting the probability of adaptation as a function of speed of vaccination. So if the speed is very fast, so you will vaccinate enough people. So again, this is one specific example, but I think it's useful to build up an intuition about what's going on. When you vaccinate fast enough, you may end up with eradicating the disease because there's enough vaccinated hosts to cut the transmission. And if you don't vaccinate at all, of course, there's no adaptation because in our numerical example, adaptation is costly. So there's no adaptation. It's only for intermediate levels of speed of vaccination that you get adaptation, because if the speed of vaccination is too high, what happens is that you have to wait too long for the mutant, and sometimes you so long that it's very unlikely to have adaptation. So basically, the recommendation from that is that if you start vaccinating, it's probably better to vaccinate faster, because first you will get the short-term benefit of vaccination, which will decrease the number of cases, but also you may decrease the probability of adaptation. So I have 5 minutes left, so I'm going to go very fast through the next step. So what I wanted to talk about next is what happens after invasion. So when the variants are in relatively high frequency, so all the variants of concern that are currently being monitored are beyond this stage because they have reached a high frequency. And the question is, can we predict what's going to happen, at which speed those variants are going to change in frequency? And for that, you can use deterministic models because they are less likely to be affected by stochasticity. So I'm not going to present this model in detail, but basically the idea in this model was to develop a model where we could consider an heterogeneity in the host population. So basically we're going to consider two types of hosts. Some hosts have a low number of contacts. So they are the low transmission hosts. So because they have a lower number of contacts, they are going to be less responsible for transmission of disease. And other hosts, in contrast, maybe they are more contacted socially and they will have a large number of contacts. So this is this parameter N, which controls the number of contacts. So there is this heterogeneity among individuals, and you may think, for example, of the age structure in human population. So young individuals have much higher number of contacts than very old people, for example. So you may wonder whether it's better to vaccinate people that have a lower number of contacts or higher number of contacts. Okay. So it's not very clear because if you vaccinate people that have a higher number of contacts, you will have a higher impact on epidemiology, but maybe those individuals have a higher risk of dying from the disease, for example, because of their age. So that's why we can try to model these dynamics. So again, so you end up with an equation like that. So you can formalize the change in frequency of the mutant and formalize the selection coefficient, which will depend on the effect of the mutation, the efficacy of the vaccine, but also on these terms here, which depend on the density of different types of vaccinated hosts, either the low and the high transmitters. And crucially, it depends also on this parameter M, which controls the higher contact rate of those individuals, the ASH individuals. And this equation, simply by looking at it, you can predict that if you vaccinate those hosts instead of those ones, there will be a higher speed of adaptation. And this is what we show in this graph here. So this is the mutant frequency against time. We start vaccinating here. So we imagine a scenario where we can apply non-pharmaceutical interventions at different time. And we see that when you start vaccinating, if you vaccinate only the highly transmitters, you see that the adaptation is much faster here than if you vaccinate only the low transmitters, as expected by this calculation. And you can also look at incidence. So this is the mutant frequency, but you also want to know what is the number of individuals that are infected. So you see that there is an epidemic that have cut by the non-pharmaceutical interventions. And if you have no vaccination, you have a huge peak when you release the control. If you maintain vaccination, If you vaccinate only H host, then you have a much higher impact on the epidemic first. So it seems to be the better strategy in terms of epidemiology because it's more effective to vaccinate individuals which have a higher number of contacts to decrease transmission. But if you vaccinate only low transmitters, there is an effect of the vaccination, but it's lower. And what happens here is that with the red strategy, there is because of the spread of the vaccine escape, you have a massive epidemic later on. So adaptation again can have a huge impact on epidemiology. And in terms of death, vaccinating highly transmitters has a huge impact on the number of deaths. So in this particular context, it's better to vaccinate low transmitters. So I won't have time to go into the multi-locus evolution. The idea was just to formalize the evolution when there are multiple locus on the virus that can respond to selection with recombination. So I think it's quite relevant in terms of COVID because we know that there are multiple mutations that can recombine between the different variants. So I won't go into that. I'm just saying that you can model that deterministically. I just want to conclude now about adaptation of SARS-CoV-2. I think it's useful to distinguish between two phases. The first phase being what happened before vaccination. So we know that because we've seen all those variants spreading globally, that there's been a lot of adaptation to human population. And that was mainly driven by the density of susceptible hosts. And of course, because of the pandemic, the virus had access to plenty of human hosts. So that's why there was a huge selection to adapt to the human population. But now we are entering a phase, a second phase, because now the virus is facing a new problem, a new challenge, which is to try to adapt to immunity. And this adaptation is driven by selection. So the intensity of selection, which is itself governed by the density of vaccinated hosts in the population. And to understand this step, I think it's important to distinguish between two types of questions, which are related, but they are nonetheless distinct. So the first one is the invasion probability. And for that, we need stochastic models that allow to account for the stochastic events of mutation and later on the stochastic event of invasion. And for example, those models can be helpful to predict that, for example, faster vaccination usually is better because it can lower the probability of invasion. And this analysis is distinct from looking at the speed of the variant spread. So when you have different variants, they can spread at different speed. And for that, you can use deterministic models. They can provide a very good understanding of what's going on. And for example, what I've discussed is the effect of targeted vaccination. So you can choose to vaccinate one host rather than another, and it can have a huge impact on the speed and on the epidemiology. And also the type of vaccines can affect the multilocular dynamics. I didn't talk about that. And I want to end by acknowledging my collaborators on that, in particular Todd, Sebastian, Dave, which were driving also the different projects that I presented in this presentation, but also Troy Day and Amaury Lambert. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Sylvain, for this very nice presentation. Very interesting. I want to know if there are any questions. You can raise your hand and ask. I will. I turn off the mic, the microphone of people, at some point. But you can speak now if you wish. If you would. Hello, Jacques.
Oui, hello. I have a question. When occurs a new mutant, there is a change of targets, and you have distinguished people having a high power of transmissibility and people a low power. But what about the pathogenicity? Because when a variant is occurring, you know, the pathogen power is different on different targets. You have mentioned, for example, H people, etc. And this change of mortality rate due to the virus is probably included in your mortality mu parameter, in your toy model, but what could be a policy specially devoted to protect these new targets, that is people, the more sensitive to the variant. You have not so much commented on that.
Right. Okay. So because I was too fast, so I'm sorry. So indeed, in the numerical example that I showed, I looked at the situations where those hosts have a higher contact rate, but I also considered the situation in this particular example where the low transmitters have a higher mortality. So maybe there are two questions in your question. So let me just answer the first one. So what I'm understanding is there is an heterogeneity in the mortality rate between these two types of targets.
Okay.
So the blue strategy here, so when we target the hell hosts, they have lower number of contact, but they also die much more.
Ah, okay.
Okay, so we consider that here, and that's why it's better when we count the cumulative number of deaths in this strategy to vaccinate the hell hosts, because if you vaccinate the hell hosts, you protect very sensitive individuals. Okay, so that's why we account for that in this particular model.
Yes, but you have four situations, people with high transmission ability, but low sensitivity, high transmission, you have related the transmissibility to the sensitivity.
Exactly, because we did this model specifically because other scientists use this model to try to address the question of who should we vaccinate? Should we vaccinate first older people or younger people? So there's been models about that by epidemiologists that assumed specifically that low transmitters, older people, have a lower number of contact, and high transmitters do not suffer from the disease. And so there is a dilemma. Which one should you vaccinate first? Because you know that if you vaccinate the high transmitters, you're going to have a huge impact on the disease. And maybe the people that are very sensitive will benefit from that as well. And if you instead you vaccinate only the sensitive people, the epidemic will go mad because you don't protect those individuals that are actually responsible for the transmission. So there is a dilemma here that has been kind of addressed by epidemiological models, and the point of doing this model was to focus not only on epidemiology but also on evolution. What is the impact of targeted vaccination on the speed of adaptation? And I think what I want to say here is that this analysis allows us to be predictive about the consequences of targeted vaccination on the speed of adaptation. I thought there was also another question, because what we considered here is that we can allow the virus to be more virulent as well. Mm. We don't consider that in this model, but in this second model that I didn't talk about, we allow for that. So we assume that there's two locus, different types of mutations. So one that allows the virus to completely escape immunity. So it escapes recognition by the immunity. So it's a bit like what I considered before. And then there is another mutation which increases virulence and transmission, which could be also a way for the virus to adapt.
And pathogenicity, you know, the mechanism of SARS is not so known, but he has apparently a high effect on certain proteins, especially immunocompetent proteins. We could happy this has not occurred, but we could imagine a new mutant having a high pathogen power, to a high mortality rate on certain parts of the population, you know.
Yeah, precisely. So that's why we try to do that in this model. So, mm-hmm. and, um, and And what is feasible in this model is to look at the dynamics of those different mutations. So, and of course, because they are linked on the genome, you need to account for the linkage decrement between those mutations. And that's what we discuss here. So, and again, you can use deterministic models to understand these more complex dynamics. So there's some work that can be done in this area.
Thank you very much.
Okay. And so I have also some question, more practical concerning your presentation. Well, it's very practical what you talked about, but in all the model you consider a constant transmission rate, vaccination rate, and so on. So it's not, it's more like a toy model each time about that, right? Do you think this will have an impact? This may have an impact to consider.
Okay, so
because the epidemic wave basically are due to those non-constant transmission rate, right?
Yeah,
and the vaccination. I mean, as far as I can see, maybe I misunderstood something, but you are considering this. That's one question, and the other one is about the first figure you show about the data from, I think it's from GISAID, right?
Covariant,
about the variant. What those kind of figure really shows?
Okay, so let me just rapidly answer the first question. So, so it is true that all the models, just for the sake of simplicity, I just assumed that transmission was constant. So in this numerical example, you can see that, so we allowed for transmission to vary in time because those non-pharmaceutical intervention, what the way we do that is just assume that transmission is reduced, okay, during the gray zone, so which leads to these waves of epidemic. And so I don't have a figure for that, but it is possible to account for those variation in transmission rate, and it doesn't affect much the dynamic. So it's just you would have a B of T, so the transmission rate would be affected by the control, for example, and it wouldn't affect that. So that's for transmission. So we can account for that, try to account for that. For vaccination, so the rate of vaccination is constant, but the, what is not constant is the of course, the number of vaccinated dose. So I don't know how to. Yeah. So the if you start vaccinating at time zero, so the number, the density of vaccinated dose will build up in time, and so this is really you account for the dynamical process of accumulation of vaccination, and that's precisely what is driving the effect of the speed of vaccination. So it's affecting the time at which you accumulate the number of hosts. So there's a, and probably the, and as I said, it's a toy model, and there would be other ways to account for the heterogeneities in time. And the second point, okay, the first figure.
Yeah, I'm very interested to know.
So precisely. This is a nice, you can, let me show. Sorry. Refer to this one, right?
This one, yes.
So you can go, if you go Google that, you will find this. So I think it's maintained by some Swiss group. So in gray you have all the variants that are no longer tracked, so those are the older variants. So I don't have the detail, but you can find all the details in this website. But this is the alpha variant, and this is the delta variant, and it comes in different shades of green because there are different mutations that are associated. But the y-axis is the frequency of the different variants at given point in time. So it's it doesn't indicate anything about epidemiology, okay? Because it's just a frequency of variants.
Yeah.
And but it's just a useful figure to show the diversity of variants and the speed at which they were able to invade. So that was quite incredible to believe that those variants could spread like that in all countries, so it indicates that selection is super strong.
But my question is, have any idea about how that data were collected, or what's the meaning? I mean, is it comparable to the? Indeed, it is just a fraction of the reported case, right?
Yes. So for example, in the so the United Kingdom were the ones that really from the beginning, from spring 2020, invested a lot in sequencing, like 5% of the cases usually were sequenced, 5% of the cases that were really positive were sequenced. And so the all this data is very precise. You see the curves are quite smooth. If you look at other countries, including France, sequencing started to build up, to increase really in 2021 after the arrival of Alpha. Because precisely of those papers, nobody wanted to invest in sequencing because it was very expensive, and everybody thought that there was no problem. It would be a waste of money because it would be the same virus over and over and again. So there is a 2020 marks a revolution in terms of the perspective we have on the evolution of viral epidemics. And so now all the countries have built up the technology, not all the countries, of course, because it's very expensive tools, but Western countries have invested a lot in sequencing. So now the data is building up in many countries. So if you go into this website, you will have a lot of data. And sometimes the data is very noisy, but like in Israel, they have a huge amount of information about those variants.
Maybe I should ask last question coming from Daozhu Gao. He asked on the chat, vaccine become less effective but not completely ineffective as a pathogen mutate. Do you consider this in your current study, in your model?
So the vaccine become ineffective, not completely effective. Yes, I mean, you can, can go back to, so it is true that, let me go to the numerical. So here I'm assuming in the numerical example that the escape mutant completely escapes the vaccine. So indeed, with those scenarios that I showed, the vaccine is completely ineffective after the fixation of the mutant. But it's very easy to use other parameter values. So for example, we could use a 0.5. So the vaccine would still be effective, but only partially effective. And then it would affect, of course, everything because it affects epidemiology. So the vaccine would be less effective against the variant, and it could also affect indeed the selection and the speed of adaptation.
So maybe I think it's time to stop this very interesting presentation and very interesting question. So thank you very much, and we will meet again next week. I think maybe next week maybe within 2 weeks, probably more probably, with a new talk. Huh? So thank you everybody, and we stop here for this. We'll stop to record. Okay. Okay. Bye bye everybody. Bye bye.